Just do a sound check. Yeah? This is the bit you never see as a rule. So it's warts and all.
And that's the way that I wanted to stay. I always wanted to be that way for my Lula. L-O-L-A. Girls will be boys and boys will be girls. It's a mixed up, muddled up, shook up world except my Lula. La 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 Lula. La 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 Lula. Everybody, come on.
Things to tell stories about the songs. Let Pete tune up. This is Pete, by the way. Let's hear it for Pete.
Man's taken all my dough and left me in my stately home, lazing on a sunny afternoon, and I can't sail my yacht. He's taken everything I've got. All I've got's a sunny afternoon. I love to live so pleasantly, live this life of luxury, blazing on a sunny in the summertime, in the summertime, in the summertime.
All together.
Oh, save me, save me, save me from this squeeze. I got a big fat mama trying to break me. And I love to live so pleasantly, live this life of luxury, lazing on a sunny. In the summertime, in the
I just want to point out that last song, Sunny Afternoon, was written when I was in a period of, it could be my blue period. In other words, I was overworked, extremely underpaid, and the Kinks were going through a bit of a crisis, which is fairly normal for us. We had just had a song called Dedicated Follower of Fashion in the charts. It was like a big, big, big song in England anyway. It wasn't a hit in America, but everywhere else. Sunny Afternoon was really a follow-up and part of that trilogy, part of the trilogy of songs, Well-Respected Man, Dedicated Follower, and now I want you to cap it all off with a song that really summed up the way I felt about living in England in 66, I think. I'll just take this jacket off here. I love burning film as a really low, I've suffered being a low budget filmmaker, as some people in the audience will testify to. And yeah, and there's nothing like burning film, I can tell you. It's a great feeling. Okay. We're gonna, it's all hit and miss, and out of this they'll get a series and they'll copyright it and they'll tell me to piss off. So. Okay. Now, the interesting thing about my family was it was a large family. I had five older sisters, and they were older. When I was 4 or 5 years old, they were all teenagers. I think that's how I got access to all this music very early on. And my older sisters played all of their bebop records on the radiogram in the bay window of the front room. The front room was very special. They put on records by Johnny Ray, Perry Como, Joe Stafford, Les Paul and Murray Ford. The first double tracking I ever heard was from a record by Kay Starr called Wheel of Fortune. My sisters did all their dances with the most recent boyfriends, everything from the tango, the creep, the smooch, boogie woogie. Saturday nights were the best night, because Dad used to get drunk, come home from the pub, and insist that we had a party. Now I know where I got it from. So my brother, Dave, and I used to watch these adults, and they'd all go out on a Saturday night because everybody would come dancing. They bought a parking lot on a piece of land where the supermarket used to stand. Before that, they put up a bowling alley on the site that used to be the local party. That's where the big band used to come and play. My sister went there on a Saturday, come dancing. All her boyfriends used to come and call. Why not come dancing? It's only natural. Another Saturday, another date. She would be ready, but she'd always make him wait in the hallway in anticipation. He didn't know the night would end up in frustration. He'd end up blowing all his wages for the week, or for a cuddle and a peck on the cheek. Come dancing. That's how they did it when I was just a kid, and all the friends would come dancing. My sister always did. Sister should have come in at midnight, and my mom would always sit up and wait. It always ended up in a big row when my sister used to get home late. Now I'm a grown up and playing in a band, and there's a car park where the pally used to stand. My sister's married and she lives on an estate. Her daughters go out, now it's her turn to wait. She knows she'd get away with things that if she could, but if I asked her, I wonder if she would. Come dancing. Come on, sister, have yourself a ball. Don't be afraid to come dancing. It's only natural. Come dancing, just like the pally on a Saturday, and all your friends will come dancing when the big band used to play. I think the driving force behind most songwriters of my ilk, I suppose, is to write hit records. We're in the popular music, and you always want the thing to be successful. And I thought I'd written this quite quaint little song with Come Dancing, you know, that had lots of catchy riffs, And our record company boss, Clive Davis, who's got Arista Records, said, "Ray, it's a great ditty, but it's not a song." That's Clive. You know, Clive's wonderful. We were with his label for a long time, longer than I can remember. But he's right in a sense. There is that ditty quality to it. But the great thing about it, when I finish the record and you mix it and you have the test pressings and everything, you play it for the first time live. And the line that really got me at the end, and I did get kind of emotional when I heard it, was when the big bands used to play. And this character, the Spiv character that I played in the video, really was somebody I knew quite well. He was an amalgamation of lots of characters. And it was his passing of an era when the big bands faded out and people like me came along with rock music and took over. And when I started playing in the first band I was in was a West Indian blues band in a club in London. And it was a great experience, but there were a few horn players and a keyboard player in particular who had been in the big bands. And they, you know, didn't take kindly to people coming along with guitars, because the guitar used to be the rhythm section. It used to be at the back. And all of a sudden we were standing in front, you know, with our legs open, with electric guitars plugged in. So it must have been a bad time. But that's what that song really is about. It's about an era and about a time.
I wish my life was a non-stop Hollywood movie show. A fantasy world of celluloid villains and heroes.
Songs I write, some of them are quite graphic, for they do a job. And I grew up in this part of North London. Anyone listening to me speak will know I'm not from Poughkeepsie. So it's a but I grew up in this part, the outskirts of North London, the villages, where it used to be Hampstead Village, Highgate Village, and a place called Muswell Hill. Muswell Hill was where the Kinks are supposed to be from, and it's true. And this song, really, my sisters used to go into London and come home with stories. Nightclubs, discotheques, gangsters, racketeers, prostitution even, organized crime. Sounds like they had a great time. But I hadn't experienced this yet. So I wrote this song imagining I was this little five-year-old listening to all these stories about this wonderful place that I never visited called London.
There's a room in a house, in a street, in a manor, in a borough that's part of a city that is generally referred to as London. It's a dark place, can be a mysterious place. And it is said that if you're born within the sound of Bow Bells, you have the necessary qualifications to be christened a Londoner. Yeah, it's a hard place, can be a wicked place. And when you think back to all the great Londoners, William Blake, Charles Dickens, Dick Whittington, Pearly Kings, Barra Boys, Arthur Daly, Max Wall, great winds through the dark alleyways and passages of London, London. But if you're ever up on Highgate Hill on a clear day, you can see right down to Leicester Square, Crystal Palace, Clapham Common, right down to Streatham Hill. North and south, I feel that I'm a Londoner still. There's a part of me that says get out. Then one day I hear somebody shout, "Sounds to me like you come from London town." But if you're ever up on Highgate Hill on a clear day, I'll be there. Yes, I will be there. the dark alleyways and passages of London, London, London.
There is a big story behind this next song, but that's for my life. The story that people want to associate with it is the fact that in Hollywood, it's a city of dreams. A lot of people go to Hollywood expecting to be stars, famous, and they end up disillusioned for the most part. But there's that wonderful street called Hollywood Boulevard. The irony, the whole thing is that all those stars with names, you know, Betty Grable, Judy Garland, all those names on the street, and you can walk all over them. And this was inspired by that street and some people I knew in that strange, strange country called Los Angeles.
Everybody's a dreamer, and everybody's a star, and everybody's in showbiz. It doesn't matter who you are. There are stars in every city, in every house and on every street. And if you walk down Hollywood Boulevard, their names are written in concrete. Don't tread on Greta Garbo as you walk down the boulevard. She looks so weak and fragile, that's why she tried to be so hard. But they turned her into a princess, and they sat her on a throne. But she turned her back on stardom, because she wanted to be alone. But you can see all the stars as you walk down Hollywood Boulevard. Some that you recognize, some that you hardly even heard of. People who worked, suffered and struggled for fame. Some who succeeded, some who suffered in vain. Everybody's a dreamer, and everybody's a star. And everybody's in showbiz. It doesn't matter who you are. But those who are successful, be always on your guard. Success walks hand in hand with failure along the Hollywood Boulevard. I wish my life was a non-stop Hollywood movie show, a fantasy world of celluloid villains and heroes. Because celluloid heroes never feel any pain, and celluloid heroes never really die. He's a well-respected man about town, doing the best thing so conservatively.
Next tune, I won't introduce it. It's a song that I wrote. It was, again, after the trilogy of songs I wrote, ending with Sunny Afternoon. I thought, why be happy all the time? So, and it does echo my own feelings of what was going on in the winter of discontent, and that was written by another writer. Good. Thank you.
up in the ceiling, and the kitchen sink is leaking. Out of work and got no money, a Sunday joint of bread and honey. What are we living for? To Rum's apartment on the second floor. No money coming in. The rent collector's knocking, trying to get in. We are strictly second class, and we don't understand why we should be on Dead End Street. People are living on Dead End Street. Don't wanna die on Dead End Street. Dead End Street. Dead End Street. On a cold and frosty morning, wipe my eyes and stop me yawning. And my feet are nearly frozen. Pour the tea and put some toast on. What are we living for? Two room apartment on the second floor. No chance to emigrate. I'm deep in debt and now it's much too late. We both want to work so hard, but we can't understand. People are living on Dead End Street. People are dying on Dead End Street. Don't wanna die on Dead End Street. 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 How'd you feel? How'd you feel? Dead End Street.
If I do die. Thanks very much.
Yep. They always ask for that one. Because he gets up in the morning and he goes to work at 9 and he comes back home at 5:30. Gets the same train every time. Cause his world is built on punctuality. It never fails. Cause he's all so good. And he's all so fine. And he's all so healthy in his body and his mind. He's a well-respected man about town. Doing the best thing so conservatively. And he plays in stocks and shares. And he goes to the regatta. He adores the girl next door. Cause he's dying to get at her. But his mother knows the best about the matrimonial shapes. Cause he's all so good, yeah. And he's all so fine. And he's all so healthy in his body and his mind. He's a well-respected man about town, doing the best thing so conservatively. I suppose it was well-respected man that turned things around for us, actually, in America. Because before that came out as a single, all our records have been straight-ahead rock and roll songs.
songs like You Really Got Me, Tired of Waiting for You, and my particular favourite, All Day and All of the Night, which we are not going to play. But you see, Well-Respected Man was different because it contained lots and lots of words. And there was one word in particular that really shook things up in America when this record came out. It was like a little stir, especially on the East Coast and parts of California. I'll sing the verse in question and see if you can spot the word.
And he likes his own backyard, and he likes his fags the best.
Now, the word fag, where I come from, is a Harry Rag cigarette, the roll-up my dad used to smoke. Right, you know what I mean, Harry Rag? Harry Rag, exactly. Oh, yeah.
Oh, Tom is young and Tom is bold. Tom is as bold as the night of old, but whenever he gets in a bit of a jam, there's nothing he won't do to get a Harry Rag. Hey, Harry Rag! Harry Rag, I'd do anything just to get a Harry Rag. Then I curse myself for the life I've led and roll myself a Harry Rag and put myself to bed. Hey! Ah, oh, the smart young ladies of the land, they can't relax without the Harry in their hand. Then they roll one up, they feel so glad, so content because they got a Harry Rag. Hey, Harry Rag! Harry Rag, I'd do anything just to get a Harry Rag. Then I curse myself for the life I've led and roll myself a Harry Rag and put myself to bed. Hey!
You asked for it.
Oh, bless your tax man, bless your all. You may take some, but you never take it all. But if I give it all, I won't feel sad as long as I've got enough to buy a Harry Rag. Hey! Harry Rag! Harry Rag, I'd do anything just to get a Harry Rag. Then I curse myself for the life I've led and roll myself a Harry Rag and put myself to bed. Hey!
So, Well-Respected Man wasn't at all like those other records. And the word fag caused quite a controversy over here. All of a sudden, though, the Kinks were being invited to play in San Francisco and the Village.
We want the Kinks here immediately.
Now, our drummer was Mick Avery, and he was proud of being very straight. So you can imagine the concern in the Avery household. Can't cope with that, Mrs. Avery. My manager thought it would be a good idea to make use of it, but I was very concerned. So let's all join in this wonderful, wonderful story. It's nothing to do with this show at all. And one more chorus of Well-Respected Man.
And he's all so good, he's all so fine, he's all so healthy in his body and his mind.
What is he?
He's a well-respected man.
What does he do? Sometimes I set myself tasks, impossible tasks sometimes. Like I tried to write an opera in a week once. I tried the most ridiculous things, the Kinks and all their famous soap opera, you know, Preservation, all these musicals. You know, there was a story going around with the band. They said, well, when I wanted to do Preservation and take him on tour, they said, well, we'll either certify him or take him on the road. They should have put me inside, I think. This is such a song. I commissioned this because I felt it would go well in my show, and it's supposed to be about all these old recompilations of Kinks records that go out, and you see them in shops, and some of them are legal and some aren't. And I thought it would be nice to have a song about a person who had such a record. And they bought this record, this old vinyl record, which I'm very fond of. The original title for this vinyl album song was going to be 12 Inches and Black. I had second thoughts after looking at the title. So I called it To the Bone, because it's about someone who comes home after a long tour, it's not very personal, to find that the one you love has gone. Most of, they always take the furniture, the best parts of the furniture when they go as well. Occasionally they leave a very telltale memento. And on this occasion, it was an old album, an old vinyl album discarded in the corner. And it was that album we shared together. It was our songs that we played when we were in love. And I don't write many songs about love. And by sheer coincidence, I also leave behind a record player. So you can be guaranteed to stay up all night and drive yourself mad. But you play it, and every track is a memory. An memory. Every little memory cuts right to the bone. In the back of a record rack, there's an old double pack. 12 inches in black, with an old crumpled cover, but every track is stacked. And it takes me back to the one who caused this melancholy mood. And every single groove cuts me to the bone. Yeah, she rocks me to the bone.
Remember when
I took her back to my bachelor flat while the stereo played for two. She unwrapped her gift, played me a riff, and said this old record was just made for you. Then we danced the songs of passion and the singer's velvet tones on the gramophone while the record played. She rocks me to the bone, knocks me to the bone. Those rocking old romantic songs played all summer long as she rocks me to the bone, knocks me to the bone.
And you play the records all night and you fall asleep over the record player and the dreams turn into nightmares. And through the nightmares you still hear that same old sad Motown backbeat.
Let's hear a Motown backbeat. In dreams she's smiling in slow motion, devouring all of my emotions. Angels singing rock and roll while demons take away my soul. Voices sound her image fades, and every time that record plays, she rocks me to the bone, knocks me to the bone. In my back room there's an old 45 that we played all summer long, shaking the beams so loud it covered up the screams. My love is humming, you went oh so wrong. And in every word, emotion is torn, and blood flows down the drain. Like she opened up a vein and cut me to the bone. Yeah, she rocks me to the bone. And now I'm just a prisoner in that stereo hi-fi jail. The needle pierced just like a nail. As she rocks me to the bone, rocks me to the bone. I had written You Really Got Me. And it happened in the front room, because all the important things happened there. Later on, back at my parents' house, I sat down in the front room and started to write a song on the piano. I thumped out these crude fifths with my left hand and Little Richard-style eighth note chops with my right. I thought of a melody to go with the phrase that I'd come up at my sister's house. Yeah, you really got me going. You got me so I don't know what I'm doing. Then I called Dave in from the kitchen where he was having dinner with the rest of the family. And as he picked up his guitar and plugged it into the green amp that we both shared, he started playing along with the riff I was punching out with my left hand on the piano. As the amp warmed up, I heard that wonderful distorted sound of the amp. I taught Dave the song, and some of our sisters came in to listen. Mum hovered around the door, because we were renowned for making lots of noise in the neighborhood, and she was afraid the neighbors would call the police. When we got through the song for the first time, our family applauded. I had written You Really Got Me, and it happened in the front room, because all the important things happened there.
Got me going, you got me so I don't know what I'm doing. Yeah, you really got me now, you got me so I can't sleep at night. Yeah, you really got me now, you got me so I don't know what I'm doing. Oh yeah, you really got me now, you got me so I can't sleep at night. See, don't ever set me free. I always wanna be by your side. Yeah, you really got me now. You got me so I can't sleep at night. Yeah, you really got me now. You got me so I don't know what I'm doing. Oh yeah.
Breaks up, you really know what special ingredients it takes to be in a band. We weren't great musicians, but I don't think groups are, because you make up for one another being in a band. And when we made this last record, or track that was a record, it was significant on the session because Pete Quaife was going to leave the band. He was one of the founding members, and he joined the band almost before I did. And on the session, he wouldn't tell us because he didn't want to say, he just wanted to bow out gracefully, just disappear. But he came over and wrote the title of the song we were doing on the recording box. You could tell he was mixed up because he misspelled it. He went D-A-Z-E. Thank you for the days. Those endless days, those sacred days you gave me. I'm thinking of the days. I won't forget a single day, believe me. I bless the light. I bless the light that shines on you, believe me. And though you're gone,
You're with me every single day, believe me. Days I remember all my life. Days when you can't see wrong from right. You took my life, but then I knew that very soon you'd leave me. But it's alright, now I'm not frightened of this world, believe me. I wish today could be tomorrow. The night is dark, it just brings sorrow, let it wait. Thank you for the days, those endless days, those sacred days you gave me. I'm thinking of the days, I won't forget a single day, believe me. I bless the light that shines on you, believe me. And though you're gone, you're with me every single day, believe me.
Yeah, just one because you stayed.
Dirty old river, must you keep rolling, flowing into the night?
Yeah, just this one because you stayed.
Dirty old river, must you keep rolling, flowing into the night? People so busy, make me feel dizzy. Taxi light shines so bright, but I don't need no friends. As long as I gaze on Waterloo sunset, I am in paradise. Every day I look at the world from my window, a chilly, chilly is evening time. Waterloo sunset's fine. Terry meets Julie, Waterloo station, every Friday night. But I am so lazy, don't want to wander, I stay at home at night. But I don't feel afraid. As long as I gaze on Waterloo sunset, I am in paradise.
At the end of our little experiment this evening, I hope you enjoyed it. Bum notes, warts and all, never mind. And I'll leave you with one line from a very famous English music hall artist. His name is Jimmy Wheeler. He's dead now, unfortunately. And he was a very bad violin player. And at the end of his act, he always used to say, "Aye, aye, that's your lot." Thank you very much. You've been very nice. Thank you.
Thank you.
met her in a club down in old Soho, where you drink champagne, it tastes just like a cherry cola. See you later.